But first, I want to begin by thanking everybody who is participating today. I know that there is a lot happening right now, and providers certainly are concerned about what's in the budget this year. So we appreciate that, given all that's going on, that you took the time to be here today. In spite of all the craziness around us and all the noise happening, managed care is also happening. And so we've got to think about how we move forward in the most sensible way. And what we've been trying to do as an agency is provide learning opportunities for our providers to hear from others, to the ability, whether it's providers within our own system, or in today's case, providers in the regular managed long-term care system. And we hope that their presentations today will be instructive and informative, and that we'll have a good amount of time for Q&A. We hope this will be helpful to everybody who's in the audience today. So I'll introduce them briefly because we want to get to their presentations. They all have incredible backgrounds in this field, and I think their slides will show the breadth of their background today. But the three speakers will include Carol Raphael, who is the Advanced Leadership Fellow at Harvard University and former CEO of the Visiting Nurse Service of New York. And she is backed by popular demand. She did a presentation to a small group of our providers. They found it incredibly informative, and so we asked her to present to a larger group. Our second presenter, and I'm not sure what order they're going in today, but I'll introduce them as they're listed. Second presenter is Randall Klein, Executive Vice President for Health Plans and Executive Director of Home First. I believe Randy used to work with Carol at VNS and has since grown in his professional capacity and done a number of impressive things in managed long-term care. And finally, Dr. Alan Morse, who is President and Chief Executive Officer of Jewish Guild Healthcare, which is a very large network that provides services not just for people with developmental disabilities, but a range of disabilities. So we're thankful that they're all willing to join us and take time out of their busy schedules today to present. So I'm going to turn it over to New York City to put up the slides and begin the presentations.
Well, good morning, everyone. First of all, Commissioner Burke, thank you so much for that introduction and for inviting us. And I'm really pleased to be here with two colleagues with whom I work, Randy Klein, who is one of the stars of the Visiting Nurse Service of New York and has gone on to do many other wonderful things, and Dr. Alan Morse, who I work very closely with.
And Carol, before you get going, we're having a little trouble hearing you here in Albany. You've got our volume turned all the way.
Thank you. Let me see. Hang on. We'll try to improve the sound and let me know if this is any better.
Slightly better.
Slightly better. Is there anything else you think I could do to improve the situation? All right. Okay, at any point, if you can't hear us, just let us know. I have been asked to share with you what it was like to become a managed care organization, and we became a managed long-term care organization, but I hope there are lessons you can learn from our experience that will be beneficial to you. There are things we've done well, there are mistakes that we made, and I hope that we'll have enough time for you to ask questions and to hear some of your observations and comments as well. So first of all, I wanted to just share very briefly who the Visiting Nurse Service of New York is. We are actually in our third century, having been founded in 1893. We're the largest nonprofit home health care agency in the United States, and we serve on any day 31,000 patients in the greater New York area, and we provide what's called post-acute long-term care, palliative care, and hospice and mental health services, and have now over 15,000 employees, and we serve a very diverse population. And I wanted to mention that we have three different managed care plans, and they tend to be for all high-cost dual eligibles in the New York City marketplace. The first one is the one that I'm going to be spending a little time describing today, and that's a managed long-term care plan that now has over 11,000 members and provides a bundle of long-term care services, and we receive a partial capitation payment from the Medicaid program in the state. But we also have a Medicare Advantage program, which covers Medicare benefits, and where we receive a risk-adjusted capitation payment from the federal government, Medicare. And we recently acquired a third health plan, which is a special needs plan for HIV/AIDS patients, and that has 6,000 members, and there we're fully capitated, and we receive a fully capitated payment from New York State Medicaid. I thought it was important to share with you what is the typical enrollee in our managed long-term care plan look like. And the average member has four different chronic diseases. If we only had someone who just had heart disease, that would be most unusual. But the most common are heart disease, diabetes, pulmonary disease, and hypertension. In addition, the average member has 4 to 5 functional deficits, and 54% suffer from moderate to severe cognitive impairment, and 77% have some form of urinary incontinence. So this is a population that is really frail and has multiple chronic conditions. In addition, I think it's important to realize that 38% speak Spanish, 11% speak Chinese. So this is also a very multicultural population that we serve. The average member is 82 years of age, but I think that really belies the real distribution, because 80% are between 75, and our whole, and actually we have quite a number of people over 100. The oldest is 106, and they're still living lives that are active in their communities. So I'm here to talk about what are the challenges of building managed care plans. And I'm going to speak about two key challenges. The first is building an infrastructure for our health plans. Remember, we at the Visiting Nurse Service of New York are providers. We provide care to sick patients. That's our essence. That's what we do. And all of a sudden, we become a health plan, a managed care entity. And so the first great challenge was to build this infrastructure, which was not something we had or in fact knew very much about. And that infrastructure involves membership services, including a call center. You have to set up a broad network. In our case, we needed to have primary care physicians who had some geriatric competency. You have to do marketing. We had never, ever done marketing. We had no marketing muscle at all that we could flex. And we had to really learn how to do marketing and enrollment and outreach and education. And then we had to make a substantial investment in information technology systems. And if you're interested, I can talk more about that. So that's one set of challenges. The second set of challenges is how do you migrate from fee-for-service to risk-based payments? You have to become a risk-bearing entity. I personally don't like to stick my head in the guillotine if I can avoid it. So in order to avoid doing that, you really have to try to understand the risk that you are taking on and what does your population look like. And you're submitting bids, and you have to really understand the cost that you're likely to incur. And then another challenge, which I don't know the extent to which you would face it, is that we are unlike a United Healthcare or an Aetna. We can't get discounts in our network, so because we have low volume. And therefore, you have to really focus on the things that you can control, which for us was preventing institutionalization and really reducing utilization that's unnecessary. And we saw the healthcare system up close and personal. We saw how a lot of our patients were suffering with really unneeded hospitalizations, with going to doctors and getting tests that they didn't really require, and the toll that it took on them and their families. And we really vowed to be a laboratory to see if we could change the way they were taken care of. And this gave us the opportunity to do that. So our model really focuses on care management. We have a very comprehensive health assessment. We visit every single enrollee in his or her home, and we spend a good deal of time with them, trying to understand what's going on. We have had to retrain our staff on what it means to be a care manager and be part of the team. We've had to work on what happens after someone is hospitalized to try to prevent it from recurring. And we've tried very hard to work on helping people to manage their own chronic condition. I can tell you we've been successful in that last one, because I myself have made home visits, and I would say to someone who's a diabetic, what should you be eating? And they'll tell me what they should be eating. And then I'll say, what are you eating? And what they are eating resembles not one whit what they should be eating. So I don't think we've yet had success in figuring out how to help people really manage their own chronic condition and prevent complications. But what we have been able to do is really set up a long-term personal relationship with the enrollees. We have much lower caseloads than national benchmarks, and we have a culture of doing whatever it takes. I mean, we have built ramps in people's homes. We've called in the exterminator if we really think there's a problem that has to be dealt with. Whatever it takes, we will do to make sure that we help people to lead the best possible lives. We spend a lot more of our premium on primary care and home care, and much less on hospitalization, and I can talk more about that as well. And the other thing I would say we have learned is that for our population, it makes more sense to have home visiting physicians and nurse practitioners than to spend the money and time on transporting them to a physician's office or a clinic where they're going to sit and wait for 3 hours. And a lot of it has to do with how you change practice and relationship on the ground. So we have had quite good outcomes. We have very good satisfaction ratings compared to the state norms. I'm always pleased when I see the high numbers of people who would recommend it to someone else, because to me that's a key test. We only 4% of our members are in a nursing home at any given time, although they're all eligible to be in a nursing home. And we really have done well on primary care. We are in the top 10% of plans on a measure on HEDIS, and we've also, in our research study, been able to drop hospitalization admission rates very substantially. So in terms of the challenges that I see, they fall into 5 areas when we want to move toward integrated care. One is how to enroll. A second is, do you have the capacity to really provide complex care management? A third is how to really set up a provider network. Fourth is quality and how to define quality for a population that isn't going to get better in many cases. And then how to engage and protect consumers. Really, really important. How to have them at the table from the outset. Not just to check it off on the list, but to really engage them as you plan and roll this out. I'm just going to end by mentioning I'm involved in a big Commonwealth Fund project called PRIDE, which is dealing with setting up managed care plans across the United States and trying to establish high-performing plans. And I've been now in many states and spent a lot of time, particularly in some of them. And I can tell you this is not just happening in New York State. This is happening across the nation, where many providers of populations that have been left out of managed care are now having to deal with the fact that they're being moved into managed care. And so we're working with providers and plans across the United States on how to do this. And I won't be able to spend a lot of time on all that we have learned, but there's a lot in terms of culture and how to scale up and really the commitment to integration, because you have to integrate services across acute, long-term care, behavioral health, et cetera, social work and nursing and physician care. And then at the end of the day, you have to attract and retain your members. They really have to believe that this is something that's beneficial, that they want to be part of. So I hope this is helpful. I'm going to turn this over to my colleagues, and I look forward to your questions.
I had a good story to tell you.
All right.
So let me start by saying that it's my honor and pleasure to be here and be here with two people that I have known through my career.
We're going to need you to speak up. We're having a hard time hearing you. Can you speak more into the microphone?
Is this better?
Yes.
So good morning. I just wanted to say that it's my honor and pleasure to be here and to be here with two people that I have known for my entire career and have a tremendous amount of respect for them and for their organizations. I'm Randy Klein. I'm the Executive Vice President for Health Plans and the Executive Director for Home First, which is a managed long-term care, primarily in New York City, but also now expanding throughout New York State. And we are starting to work with developmentally disabled organizations. Most recently, we're now starting to work with NYSAR. And I'll get into that in a little bit. So background on Elder Plan, Home First, and MGHS. We are also in an old organization. We've been around 105 years. You probably have seen some of our ads with the Four Brooklyn Ladies. That's a true story, and it's the roots of the organization. We are a provider-based organization, and at this point, even though managed care is the largest business unit within MGHS, we still think of ourselves as providers first. That said, we've learned a fair amount by being a participant in managed care going back into the 80s. So starting with our history, Elder Plan was founded in 1980 as one of the original Medicare social HMOs. Our system CEO used to actually have a license plate on his car that said SHMO on it for social HMO. But the social HMO was a really remarkable program. It was a Medicare program that was designed to enroll individuals who had a nursing home level of care need but could reside in the community. And plans that were social HMOs received an additional capitation from Medicare in order to maintain these individuals in the community. Elder Plan was one of the original, one of the leaders in that, and it was successful at doing that. And to this day, that's the foundation of much of our care model. Unfortunately, the program was better at saving Medicaid money than Medicare. So in 2003, they actually changed the regs under the Medicare Modernization Act and converted it into special needs money. So over time, that transition led to a bunch of iterations of what Elder Plan and Home First were. First, we became a disproportionate share Medicare special needs plan, and then we became an institutional special needs plan. I'm not going to get into all the details of this, other than to say that all of these different flavors kind of led us back to the same point, which is that we were good at managing frail individuals, particularly those with dual eligibility, in the community. On the other side of the house, on the home care side, they also started a managed care program that was managed long-term care. That is the program that BMS and My Choice started out as, and that's also where Virgilent started in their managed care arena. That program and Elder Plan's Medicare program were merged in 2011, primarily because of the move towards integrated care for dual eligibles. We had started down that path actually a couple of years earlier, recognizing that these two funding streams coming together was an important way of improving both the quality of care for dual eligibles as well as reducing the expense associated with them. At this point, we are in 9 counties for Medicare, and we are in 42 counties for managed long-term care. So what is managed long-term care? When I first started out, most people had never heard of managed long-term care. When I would tell people that I worked with managed long-term care, they would say, what is that? And I'd say, well, it's a type of managed care. And they'd say, do you pay for hospitalizations? No. Do you pay for doctors? No. What do you pay for? Well, what we pay for is home and community-based services. In New York today, 90% of managed long-term care members are in not-for-profit provider-based plans. Managed long-term care plans, by and large, do a very good job for their membership. They maintain them in the community. They maintain them with very high levels of satisfaction. This is the type of plan that when my own family members needed care, that I sought them out. And my family is from Rochester, New York. And what I found was that there was, at that point in time, no managed long-term care plans in Rochester. And it made me thankful for those that live in New York City that they have them available. Today, that's not the case, and those plans, including mine, do exist up there. The focus is on a long-term relationship. Managed long-term care plans provide care managers for their beneficiaries that have a relationship that spans years. Our average enrollee is about 7 years. Now, we have an exceptionally low level of voluntary disenrollment, about 1.5%. So most of the time when people leave the plan, they leave the plan because they've moved out of the area. They've entered a long-term stay in a hospital and we can't get them out. We're generally pretty good at getting them out. That they pass away. That's the most common way we recommend is to pass away. And we think of that as overall success. That's, I think, what we would all want for ourselves and for those we care about. Managed long-term cares have a different approach than a traditional managed care towards care, in that they are focused really on managing the benefits for the individual, making sure that they have the necessary services in place, like what Carol was saying, putting in ramps, widening doors, air conditioning. And those are all things that we do, but also making sure that the personal care worker is in place, that when they have confinement, when they go to the hospital, that the care manager is following them through that and getting them back out into the community safely. The other part about being a managed long-term care is that you are, in fact, an insurance company, and you have to manage capitation and a premium. And that's a really challenging thing to do, because it basically means that you're predicting the future at all points in time, and as we all know, past performance is not a perfect indicator of future success. So a lot of time goes into analytics and systems. Actuaries become a very important part of understanding how you're performing, how you're going to perform, and things like rate adequacy and contracts and other fun things start to take up a lot of your life as well. In order to become a managed long-term care, you have to obtain a certificate of authority from the state. This is an arduous and daunting process to put together an application, to pass a site readiness review, to put together all of the operating policies and procedures, and to get the staff trained in order to demonstrate that they can actually perform the functions of a managed long-term care. You have to contract a network. Contracting a network is also more challenging than it sounds. Figuring out what are the payment incentives that you want to put in place for providers in order to have them want to do the right things for the patients. How are you going to work with them? How are they going to support the quality objectives of the overall plan? You have to build and maintain reserves. One of the things that comes up in conversations about being a managed care is, well, when I look at your balance sheet, I see X. Don't you have plenty of money? Well, there's a requirement that the state has for any managed care to have a certain amount of dollars that they sit in reserves. Those reserves need to exist in order to protect against adverse events. What happens if your population suddenly gets really sick? The providers need to be able to get paid, and the patients need to be able to get the care that they require. Presently, for a managed long-term care, that's a 5% reserve requirement. So if you're a $100 million managed long-term care, in terms of the revenue that you manage, you would have to maintain at least $5 million in reserves. And then the reporting requirements are pretty significant. manage long-term care, as I've talked about the benefits. When I look at the room here, you're interested in DISCO. And when I compare DISCO to manage long-term care, they look fairly similar. There are obviously substantial differences between the two, particularly with regard to the population served. But in both cases, you're talking about organizations that are being set up to assure individual care and continuity across settings, with more of a focus on the long-term care type components, the home community-based components, than on the acute care components. Managed long-term cares, I talked about the care manager. They also have staff. They have interdisciplinary care teams. What we do at Elder Plan is we've got a care team that's going to be centered on a nurse or a social worker. We use a lot of social workers because much of what we're doing is managing the benefits that an individual needs in order to take care of basic needs as opposed to clinical needs. One of the advantages of a managed long-term care plan is that if you've got long-standing physician relationships, when you join the managed long-term care plan, you can continue those. On the Medicare Advantage side or the mainstream Medicaid side, you have to choose a network physician as well. Patient advocacy was mentioned before. It's an important piece of this. A plan like the Elder Plan spends a lot of time making sure that the patient gets what they need, both from the plan as well as from providers that sit outside the plan. However, the state has also set up a system to ensure that if there's disagreements, if the patient or their family thinks that more services are needed or disagrees with the type of services that the member has to complain, the members have sensitive appeal rights. And what happens there is that this is something that I'm proud to say doesn't happen with a great degree of frequency for us. If a member is seeking additional services and we make a decision that those services aren't appropriate, the member can appeal that decision. The first level of appeal goes to the internal appeals coordinator, who is going to evaluate how that decision was made and reconsider. Most of the time, the original appeal is upheld because our care managers have used data and experience and judgment to come up with what they wanted to approve. The one thing that our care managers never do, there's no financial incentive for them to make one decision or another. It's always based on what is the best interest of that member, and it's based on assessment and data. So any individual that's coming into our plan, they get a comprehensive assessment. When they join, they get a comprehensive assessment every 6 months. And if there's a significant change in the condition, they get a comprehensive assessment. If someone requests service, we will do whatever is the appropriate assessment at that point in time. And most of the time, the member is satisfied with what they receive. But when it does happen that the member is dissatisfied, or it does happen that the member has a problem with one of our network providers, we have to investigate it and take it seriously. So in the event that there's a disagreement and it goes through that first level, it gets to the second level, the member still has further rights beyond that, and the member can appeal to a fair hearing, where it goes before an administrative law judge to determine whether or not the plan has made the right decision. Again, that's something that happens with a very, very low degree of frequency. We don't want that to occur. It's a time-consuming thing. It's not good for the member. It's not good for the plan. But when people join, they should have a high degree of confidence that they're going to have access to what they need. So lessons learned over the time being in the managed care. One is that it takes a team. A team includes a lot of individuals. It starts with the family and the patient. We need to have that patient and family involved in their care plan at the point of enrollment. They have to buy into it, they have to accept it, and they have to do their best to live by it. There's a care manager that plays a critical role. I think of them as the quarterback of that team. They're the ones that are responsible for making sure that all of the other services are being brought in as necessary. We have an interdisciplinary care team that wraps around the care manager. That's going to include rehab, social work, other providers as necessary, We have staff pharmacists, we have medical directors who get involved as necessary. And then the ability to reach out to the community provider. When someone joins our plan, we need the physician to be involved in approving that care plan. So that's something else that's important. When someone doesn't have a physician when they join the plan, which occurs, we're going to try and connect them with one. And the goal is to improve the independence and quality of life. It's a really an individual-centered approach to things. The other thing that we've learned is that, so when Medicaid reform started a couple years ago, there was this slide that the governor put out, which showed all of the Medicaid programs, and Carol can talk about this in first-hand experience because she chaired one of the committees, but there was this slide that the governor put out which showed the growth of enrollment in Medicaid programs alongside the growth in cost of those programs. And managed long-term care stood out because it had significant membership growth with basically flat cost growth. So one of the big questions becomes, how do you do that while still achieving very high levels of quality and satisfaction? And this is what we've done at Elder Plan. So we've developed care plans that really meet the members' needs. It's less expensive typically to provide care in the setting that the member wants to receive care, in the least restrictive setting. Lots of introspection, operational analysis. Where can we save money on our own operations? And that's part of the motivation for merging Elder Plan and Home First. Creating those provider networks that support the care delivery, those financial incentives that support the care delivery in a way that is going to make the most sense, in a way that's going to promote primarily home and community-based care. And ensuring that the providers are billing appropriately. Sort of taking the darker view on things, which is not every provider is going to act in the way that they should. So we as a managed care plan have an obligation to monitor for fraudulent and wasteful activities. So that's another piece that we get involved in. Other lessons that we've learned is that you can't be too aggressive on this. So when I look at the plans for DISCO and I look at what's coming down the pipe, I think it's important to realize that the power of managed care is not in terms of day one finding huge savings. I don't think that happens. I think that if you try and make massive changes right off of the top, you're going to have a lot of unintended consequences. So one of the ways that we've been able to do it is by preventing people from declining. We're much better at keeping someone who comes in a state where they're at risk of declining and keeping them healthier longer than we are taking someone who is already very sick and frail and making them better. I don't think that works quite as well. The other part is that you can, as it says, lose your shirt if you don't know how to assume the manage risk. This part of the financial know-how of projecting costs in managed care it takes a lot of time and a lot of experience to develop. When I look at the DD population and I look at the data that I've seen on the DD population, one of the things that occurs to me is that we still don't really know a great deal about how it's going to look in a managed care environment. So because of that, I think assuming sort of a conservative approach to that is going to help protect the patients and the providers and the plans that choose to enter the space. Other lessons. The skills that it takes to manage a well population through an acute episode, the way that a commercial managed care does, are not the same ones that it takes to manage long-term care. You need someone that understands how to manage across the continuum, which is different than if someone has a heart attack and getting them out. And you have to teach the people that are doing that care management how to think in that way. Also, that things that matter in the long-term care environment, such as access to transportation, are very important, whereas on the acute side, it may not be quite as important. Lastly, that aligning Medicare and Medicaid is much harder than it appears. So for a population such as the one that you all service, which has a high penetration of dual eligibility, when managed care comes into this, you're going to need to make sure that you have astuteness and that you have providers that have astuteness about how to how to deal with the conflicts between Medicare and Medicaid, and how to bill appropriately under that, and how to set financial incentives that work to manage those two payment schemes. So in terms of applying these lessons to DISCOs, the partnership between service experts, people that understand the population, and people that understand how to manage risk is going to be very important. So choose someone that knows what it means to be a managed care, choose someone that knows what it means to service DP. You're going to need strong coordination across the continuum. You're going to have to make sure that premiums are adequate. That gets to that conservatism piece. When they're setting premiums for DISCO, you want to make sure that encompasses what your present level experience is. And the other part, when I look at the 24-month pilot period, I wonder if it's long enough. I wonder if you don't want to have a slightly longer pilot period to prove out whether or not you're actually creating the savings that you expect. And that's my presentation.
The Guild usually is very much ahead of the curve, at least in terms of thinking about things. This title, in the context of what took place in Rome yesterday, seems very appropriate. I actually picked it a few months ago, so there is no religious connotation. Always a pleasure to be with Randy and Carol. Their work, their programs have been extraordinary. Carol's leadership on the Medicaid redesign team, of which I had the pleasure serving on the Imagine Long-Term Care subgroup was extraordinary, and this is a new world. As our leader in Albany, Jason Helgeson, the state Medicaid director, is fond of saying, it's time for care management for all. The Guild is a different organization from typical managed care entities. And I think I can say the same for both Randy's and Carol's. What we have in common is we all come from a very, very deep tradition of service provision. We are not mainstream insurance companies. We're not Cigna. We're not Aetna. We provide service. We've done it for 100 years, as they have. The Guild, that's our headquarters, focuses on problems of people with vision loss, but people with vision loss also have other problems. Among those are developmental disability. We've been a developmental disability provider, services provider, for much of our history and continue that today. The kinds of programs the Guild runs span the gamut of human services. Our services are primarily licensed. These are but a few of them. And what they all have in common is they deal with people with vision loss, whether they're children with multiple disabilities, behavioral problems. We have a developmental disability treatment program, crisis counseling, psychiatric clinic, on and on. And today we're going to talk a little bit about GuildNet, which is our variation of managed long-term care. I would be remiss if I didn't start with a little bit of introduction about vision, because I think whatever the population you're addressing, it's really, really important to know how their particular characteristics affect the service delivery system. So when we're looking at people with vision loss in long-term care, we go back and we look at literature, and we find that it's pretty well-rounded, and there is a decline in vision status that's associated with lower social, emotional, and physical functioning. People who are blind experience significant ADL limitations compared to those who are more sighted. Particularly important is onset of blindness. Is linked to a very, very substantial increase in dependency and need for ADL. Now, we're talking a lot about vision. In the population that you deal with, you have similar knowledge about your population, which is unique, and it would be a mistake to take a generic managed long-term care plan and apply it to a developmentally disabled population and assume it's going to work. You have to know the people you're talking with about. So when you look at visually impaired people, to continue, we find they're less satisfied with their health care. They experience more problems after discharge from acute care facilities. Their vision loss contributes significantly to excess hospital length of stay, and the need for rehabilitation care post-discharge. That was true in 1999 when I did that study. That remains true today, but I'm pleased to say less so, as acute care facilities are becoming a bit more sensitive to the needs of people with vision loss. So when we look at that overall, we see the vision adds to the complexity of healthcare delivery and impacts significantly on utilization and is a generally overlooked contributor to excess healthcare costs. You could make the same statement about each of the populations and subpopulations that each of you deal with. They are all unique, and it's important to look at all of their distinct and unique attributes. Let's talk a minute about New York's Medicaid program. This may be information that you know, but it's worth repeating. New York is first in the country on per capita spending under Medicaid. Now, in New York, we're proud of that because it means that we give more service than anyone else. We also cover nursing home care, which is not ubiquitous across all 50 states. But the fact is, we do spend more. Significantly, of the population we serve in Medicaid, 15% are dually eligible, meaning they have Medicaid and Medicare, or they qualify for it. And that 15% accounts for 45% of Medicaid spending. So 15% of the Medicaid population accounts for three times that in terms of Medicaid spending, which is obviously disproportionate, and accounts for almost the same percentage in Medicare. So people who are dually eligible tend to be very, very needy in terms of services. In managed long-term care, we use an instrument currently called the semi-annual assessment of members, which is used to determine the severity of illness and the care needs of the population. The items on the left side of the screen are disease-oriented, except for the first one, which is the statistical compilation. The items on the right side are functionally-oriented. This instrument is changing as we speak. In the next few months, they'll be transitioning to another instrument, but also very, very similar. That instrument is used to help determine eligibility for services within the Medicaid MLTC benefit package. As you can see from this list, it's an extraordinarily complete package, as I think Randy pointed out. It doesn't cover doctors. It doesn't cover hospitals. It covers Medicaid long-term care services. So on the Medicaid capitated part of the program, and we all have both Medicaid and Medicare covered as well, but on the Medicaid part, we cover Medicaid long-term care services. This is an example of what happens with the capitation rate and how it comes about. This slide is also dated. It's about 3 months old, and 3 months ago, on the very bottom, you see that there's a 3% inclusion for net profit or surplus. Over the last few months, that's very quickly evolved from 3 to 2 to 1, and the state will continue to squeeze and find ways of making the program even more cost-effective. But this shows you the relative distribution of services in an average MLTC plan. This is an amalgam of all of our plans. It doesn't represent any of the three of us or any other particular plan in the state. As I think Carol indicated, a very significant part of the premium goes towards personal care services, not towards skilled nursing. We're all very proud of the fact that we do well for our consumers if we're able to keep them healthy at home and receiving their care at home and not within an institutional environment. Very briefly, the SAM is a scorable instrument which results in a risk score, which is compared to the risk score of other MLTCs in our region, and we end up with a risk-adjusted payment, which looks a lot like a standardized score, a deviation score, for those of you who are familiar with normal distributions. So when we look at our population, as I said, we have two distinct models, a partially capitated and a fully capitated. When we look at our population, we see that it's similar to what you saw from VMS. About 83 or 84% of our members are newly eligible. The majority of them we've kept in our managed long-term care program and are only now beginning to switch them into the newly capitated program. We've been very, very deliberate, and this is a question, we've been very deliberate in moving people into that program because we're not sure that the rates are adequate, and we think there's substantial financial risk. I think Randy mentioned that on the Medicare side, that risk is extraordinary because when you're capitated for Medicare services, you're capitated for virtually all of the acute care, really severe illnesses, cancer, heart disease, transplants, very, very, very expensive services. And if you have a small population, and you have one person who has one of these conditions, it could break the bank. So we've been very, very, very cautious, and of course, as your actuaries will advise you, and you can't do this without actuaries, don't even think about it. You want to have stop-loss insurance and all kinds of safeguards in place, without which you're at extraordinary financial risk. So our population is a little bit younger than BNS's. Our average age is about 75 or 76. About 70% of our population is female, and almost half of them live alone. So how do we do this? We start out with a group of people, intake nurses, and our staff are largely comprised of nurses, social workers, and various people who work with them as extenders. Nurses are required to do the assessment. Every one of our members receives an in-home assessment. Where we can, we use our own nurses. The population is growing so rapidly that occasionally we subcontract with other people, and that's a second lesson to learn, is that you need not build it yourself if you can buy a bed elsewhere. So in our model, we repeatedly follow that mantra. If we can buy claims processing from someone who does claims processing, it's far easier, cheaper, and more efficient for us to do that than to set it up ourselves. So our claims, the claims of each of our providers, are processed through a very, very large claims processing center in Atlanta, Georgia. After they've been authorized by staff at the Guild here in New York, after the provider has submitted bills into the system electronically. The advantage of all of this, of course, is when you're on a computer, it doesn't make a difference where you are. Things come together very nicely in one place. And you don't need to provide things yourself that you can buy elsewhere. After the nurse completes the intake, the individuals are assigned to teams. And our teams are led either by RNs or by MSWs. In the beginning, we used RNs exclusively, and as we learned, the care drivers for a lot of our members are not medical. They're social and their social needs. We found that in many cases, social workers are better equipped to deal with those kinds of problems. But because they also have healthcare problems on every team, whether it's led by a nurse or by a social worker, there is an RN. We have member service, we have reassessor nurses, of course, who have to go out and do the reassessments that are required currently every 6 months or on substantial change of condition. We have member services reps who are the people who deal with the members on a daily basis or as frequently as they call in for all of their needs. And the member services reps transfer that information to the team, which then decides on the appropriate services and the care plan. And because we have so many subgroups within our population, and I don't have vision on here because that goes without saying, but like BNS, our number one diagnosis right now is diabetes. About a third of our population has diabetes. Diabetes, as all of you know, is also a leading cause of vision loss. So we have folks with diabetes, with vision loss, and may have mental health needs, palliative care needs, intensive-based management needs, along with the 4, 5, or 6 diagnoses that have been referred to previously. So what is the goal of care management in Gilbert? Well, like all MLTC programs, the goal is to maintain an optimal level of functioning for that individual and to avoid having to transfer them to more expensive levels of care. Being capitated means that you're at financial risk for those other levels of care. Nursing home is a covered service. So if you're providing care for someone at home and it's costing you $150 a day and they transfer to nursing home, it's going to cost you, on average, about twice that in New York City. So you're far better off financially caring for the member at home. The member is far better off, if they can be maintained at home, staying in their own home environment. The key is to find the appropriate level of utilization for the appropriate service. Managed long-term care rationalizes service use, not maximizes service use. Under some previous healthcare models, particularly fee-for-service, the incentives were to provide more care, whether or not the care was necessary. Under managed care, when the organization is capitated, the focus is on providing the right care, the right time, the right place, the right cost, because if you don't, you're a financial risk. The Olmstead Act, which is something I'm sure you're all familiar with, is carried through in managed long-term care, and care planning must include the member in the decision-making role if they're competent to do that, or their surrogate, has to address quality of life issues, and has to actively support member preferences. This is not like going into the hospital and the doctor decides what kind of operation you need and he's going to do it. Patients don't walk into hospitals demanding an appendectomy. They wait until the doctor tells them they need it, the doctor tells them what he's going to do, they sign a consent, and he does it. These programs are the full participation of members in the care plan. So we have agreement by the member, whenever possible, their family, their healthcare decision makers if they're involved, because these are the people who are going to complain about the care, who are going to go to hearings, fair hearings, if they're not happy with the care, and even if it wasn't required, you certainly want to have them all in the process from the outset. The coordination of care is not only among the services that you're capitated for, but you're required to refer and coordinate all of the non-covered benefits as well. So this means you can't absent yourself from the decision-making process about someone's care because a service isn't covered. You really are their care manager. You really are the professional, your organization is the professional that knows what services are available in the community, knows how to get them, knows where they are, whether or not you're capitated for it. The capitation is only one small piece of the puzzle. Monitoring utilization is key. And both Carol and Randy talked about IT. You can't do this kind of a program, no matter how small your program is to start. You can't do it without sophisticated IT systems to report, track, and monitor services all the time. If you don't do that, you will lose sight very quickly of cost, and you'll go off the cliff. You need to monitor both the clinical services, service utilization, the cost of services, because some providers are more expensive than others. Is it really necessary to go to Sloan Kettering for something that is not cancer-related? They're a very good provider, but they're also very expensive. So if you're off budget, or if you're off track clinically, you need to know that immediately. To give you some idea of what our program looks like, and this is not current, we don't have the 2012 data in there. In the slide on the left, you can see the SAM scores and how they have increased over the years, and how those over 65 are always considerably higher than those under 65. This is not anomalous to our program. It applies across most of the other MLTCs as well. With the DD population, I'm not sure it would be as true. You may have younger consumers who might have more acute needs. On the slide on the right, we go up and down a little bit, you see the relationship between our risk score and the relative risk score. So the raw score is the score that we generate by ourselves. The relative score is what happens to our risk score after it's been adjusted by the regional average. If you are getting the impression that there's a lot of IT and financial and accounting and actuarial and other kinds of infrastructure necessary, you're getting the right idea. This is not a care-centric program from the top. It's care-centric for the member, but you need a lot of other things to do the program properly. So there are opportunities within managed care that are worth mentioning. From the point of view of the consumer, they're able to get coordinated integrated care. And in any healthcare or service delivery structure, that really is the key to getting good care. That's an extraordinary opportunity. Right now, our service delivery system is fairly fragmented, and you look at the statistics, for example, on the U.S. in healthcare, we spend the most and we get the least of any industrialized country. So we have the best medical science, we probably have the poorest healthcare of any industrialized country. So the ability within managed care to have that coordinated and integrated is a big plus. It also gives you the ability to address specialized needs. This is not a one-size-fits-all program. Our population has a preponderance of vision loss. We address that. Other programs have physical disabilities or emotional or mental issues. They address that. You can customize the program to meet the needs of the consumer, and if you do that, you end up with coordinated integrated care that's the right care for that particular person. That creates marketplace differentiation and specialization. One of the failures of the state, and this has been an ongoing dialogue we've had with them, is their inability to understand the differences between providers. Each of us have specialties in our programs, and yet the state in their wisdom is unable to take account of those differences. So when you have mandatory enrollment, as we have now, if individuals don't choose a plan, they're auto-assigned to a plan. How are they auto-assigned? Randomly. So a person who has vision loss might be assigned to a program that doesn't deal with vision loss. A person that has mental health issues might be assigned to a plan that doesn't deal with that. So one of the shortcomings of the state is their inability to fully understand the unique attributes of each of the programs it has within the state. And we're very fortunate in New York because we have an extraordinary array of very, very good providers, almost all of whom are not-for-profit, based originally as a service provider, which gives us a very rich program. There also is the potential for the state to gain financial control through capitation. Unlike fee-for-service, where at the end of the year they add up all the services they're delivering and they can figure out what it costs, the state can determine upfront how much it's going to spend per consumer and have a fixed budget. One of the extraordinary successes in New York about a Medicaid program in the last few years is despite significant growth in enrollment, this is now the second year, I believe, in a row, where we stayed under the Medicaid budget cap. Enrollment is going up, services are being enriched, members are getting more and better service, and yet the state is paying a fixed amount, and it's within budget. That's an extraordinary achievement. That also has the opportunity for financial gain for each of the plans if they understand how to do effective care management. So we have some challenges. The first is the one I referred to a few minutes ago, mandatory enrollment on the side. If we are assigned someone for whom we're not the most appropriate plan, as with an insurance company being assigned a driver that they don't want to insure, you don't have a choice. You've been assigned that individual, you're going to provide care for them, even if you're not the most appropriate plan. That's an extraordinary challenge. And I think New York would be well advised to look at the differences between each of the plans. The assessment of needs is currently being done by the SAM. It's going to be done by an instrument which has also been adopted by OPWDD, the UAS. The UAS is an extraordinarily complex instrument produced by a fine series of academics internationally designed initially to produce a research database. It is not designed to produce a reimbursement rate. In New York, we're transferring knowledge from the patient database, the UAS, into a system that will result in reimbursement. No one has seen how that crosswalk is going to take place from the existing to the new. So none of us know whether there's going to be a radical change in rates unless the system comes in, and that all of us are committed to providing services at a given level. So I think we need to have more forthcoming data from the state as to how that's going to take place. Right now, I don't see it. and I don't know whether my colleagues have, but I certainly have not understood how they're going to get from a clinical database to a fiscal reimbursement system seamlessly. Consumer rights and entitlements. This is New York and this is America. We believe in consumer rights and entitlements. Goes without saying. The issue is, how far do those rights go and where do they stop? The old adage in tort law is, my right to sue my fist stops when it hits your face. And here you have the same kind of thing. A consumer's right to get whatever they want has to have some limitation. So where those things exist, you then end up with fair hearings or something like that. And as Randy indicated, that's not the direction you want to go. Home care versus managed care is something that might not be applicable to your population. It was for ours. There were extraordinary numbers of people who were getting services under a multitude of programs in New York that were substantially what the consumer wanted. Not necessarily what they needed, but in some cases actually what they wanted. As you transition from a consumer-centric program where they dictate what they want to a managed care model where they get what they need, there's friction. The hearing process we can skip. The administrative issues are legion, from electronic enrollments to consistency of computer forms to managing contractual relationships. Our provider base on the Medicaid side has about 500 providers. On the Medicare side, we're using a network that's owned by one of the large insurance companies, and we have 55,000 providers. How do we communicate our policies to all those people all the time and make sure when someone walks into their office or their clinic or their hospital, they understand what those people are entitled to? That's a challenge. Rules and regulations and procedures between Medicare enrollment and Medicaid enrollment are very technical. I'm not going to go into it other than the fact that there is a significant issue in Medicare enrollment as compared to Medicaid, which at the current moment, I believe, involves three people being on the phone at the same time to all be the members saying the same thing. That's a real challenge. Who do you put on first? Let's get the commissioner on first and have her all hold and wait. We're trying to get somebody to sue. Final caveat is, without a controlled capitated marketplace, care costs will continue to skyrocket. So Jason is right, all roads do lead to Rome, and it is care management for all. But there are challenges, and we need to be aware of them before you get too heavily involved in the program. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you to all three of our presenters today. I noticed that you did have some similar themes. I guess one of the ones being probably the most daunting is the need for an information technology and related infrastructure. I think you all mentioned that. One thing that I did find positive about what all of you said is how important it is to involve the individual who's receiving the services in the care planning process, in the development of their plan, in the assessment, in all of the services going forward. So that was reassuring because I think our system does that very well right now. So that's good to hear. So we have six sites, which includes the